from this AUA. One is looking at the use of 4K score and when do you integrate MRI. So first, starting off with 4K, potentially skipping biopsy entirely if it's low, moving directly to biopsy if it's high, and integrating MRI as sort of a decision-making tool. Another group looked at PCA3 instead and took it head-to-head against MRI, and then either started with PCA3, followed up by MRI to avoid 76% of biopsies, but miss about half of high grade, or sequence it the opposite way, starting with MRI and then using PCA3 to avoid about a third of biopsies, but only miss 5% high grades. So this suggests the following schema. You're looking at the blood and urine markers conventionally available, as well as the ones presented this year with tremendous promise, iso-PSA, kallikrein, oncosomes, and the androgen receptor. Potentially, if you have high-quality multi-parametric MRI available, you could start with that. If not, go directly to one of these markers. If you have the MRI, start with your MRI, use a PI-RADS 3 cutoff, and then use a marker as a determinant for equivocal, or go directly to targeted biopsy and skip the marker if the MRI is over PI-RADS 3. MRI fusion biopsy had over 200 abstracts presented this year at the AUA. So what I did was pull together data from big trials to get some big take-home messages. First, there's no difference in visual estimation, or what we call cognitive fusion, versus fusion software-based technology. Second, when you compare multi-parametric MRI fusion, it does better at overall detection compared to truss biopsy alone, but about equal identification of high-risk disease. And then lastly, as a cutoff, the PI-RADS 3 and above appears to have significant association with detection of cancer from biopsy, both from a large group in the UK as well as Australia. There was a debate about transperineal versus transrectal biopsy approaches. Both of these can be done with MRI fusion, cognitive, or software. A lower infection rate was seen with transperineal biopsy, but with this is a caveat that this requires anesthesia and there's an impact on the health system as well as costs. Next, data from some big trials, ERSPT, PROTECT, and PIVOT. The PROTECT trial once again showed no difference in metastases and death after 15 years of follow-up. The ERSPT versus PROTECT trial, presented by Dr. Drost, showed low and intermediate risk prostate cancer patients had no difference in overall survival when you compare active treatment, which is surgery or radiation, versus active monitoring. And the PIVOT trial presented its 20-year data comparing surgery and observation and showing no decrease in prostate cancer overall mortality and no decrease in prostate cancer survival. So moving on to surgery, this was a hot topic. There were a lot of exciting trends. One was that the technique, whether you do it open or robotic, is not as important as experience and expertise. The second was crowdsourcing, which actually can identify expertise. Open and robotic approaches were equivalent in outcomes and quality of life, but appear to be better than pure laparoscopic. And then two areas to be excited about for the future. One was fluorescent antibody labeled lymph nodes for identification of cancer, and the RedCS sparing approach. So moving on, just a few quick slides about data on these. This group looked at the complication rates, which were strongly associated with surgeon experience. The music group from Michigan looked at surgeon variation, with the highest performing surgeons actually having the best outcomes. And this actually did not fall out when you adjust for risk, so they still had the best outcomes. This group looked at laparoscopic versus robotic prostatectomy and found better functional results with robotic approach. This is the CROSS-QA trial that looked at open versus robotic and found no difference in health-related quality of life changes over time. However, they did see decrease in blood loss, length of stay, and complications with a robotic approach. So once again, the technique appears equivalent, and the surgeon is what matters. This is one of the best abstracts on crowdsourcing. Was able to identify top-performing surgeons, and those top-performing surgeons actually had lower readmission, lower EBL, lower indwelling catheter replacement. Shifting gears a little bit to focal therapy, which is a strong emerging technology. This is the best abstract that showed you need an 11-millimeter margin for ideal treatment. Now switching a little bit to some of the really exciting genetic and precision medicine abstracts. This is a late-breaking abstract that showed there was no difference, no racial disparity in terms of genetic variability in prostate cancer. and that significant inter-institutional variations potentially were the reason for racial disparities seen in other trials. Having said that, when you look at primary and metastatic prostate cancer, many, many abstracts found that BRCA2 is strongly associated with these, and with this best abstract, these were also seen in low-risk cancer cases as well. So these germline DNA mismatch repair genes are an important emerging thing to follow. This is the precision medicine best abstract, which found that patient-derived samples were able to be successfully cultured in vitro, talking about precision medicine, individualized care. This is powerful stuff for men with biochemical recurrence and future prostate cancer treatment. This, I think, is an important abstract to spend just a moment on. This was data from the OPCO registry, and it shows how we treat our men with prostate cancer in the United States. Now, take a look down here. This is stratified by the Kaplan risk score. And this shows how we treat very low-risk men. The reason I'm calling this out is because now I'm going to present the localized prostate cancer guidelines. And if you look at this, you see about 60% of low-risk men are still getting treated. And if we follow our guidelines, that's all about to change. So these are the localized prostate cancer guidelines from the AUA. It's a risk stratification using grade groups, which is why I started out with that as the definition. If you look at very low risk and low risk, for very low risk men, there's a strong recommendation we should be doing active surveillance for these men. For low risk men, again, a moderate recommendation for active surveillance, selective radical prostatectomy or radiotherapy in high risk men, and no evidence to support focal therapy. Looking at the intermediate risk group, and I think this was something that's very different, it's broken into favorable and unfavorable risk. For both of these risk categories, we should be offering them either radical prostatectomy or radiation of ADT. There's a conditional recommendation for active surveillance in the favorable intermediate risk group, and once again, no evidence to support HIFU or local ablative therapy. The high-risk patients, this excluded anyone T3, T4, we should be staging them with CT, MRI, or bone scan. We should be offering them radical prostatectomy or radiotherapy with ADT as a standard treatment. We should not be doing active surveillance. We should not be doing focal therapy or primary ADT on these patients. And then bringing it back to the genetics I had highlighted, this is the first time the guidelines for prostate cancer have included considering a referral for genetic counseling for patients with high-risk disease, those who have BRCA2. For those of you who saw the plenary, you know this ended with a think moment. So think about screening what not only the men but their families as well. I just want to say thank you once again for the honor of presenting this. Thank you to the scientists for some breathtaking work this year and providing hope to not only patients.